Simon & Schuster Audio presents Ponti, a novel by Sharlene Teo, read by Vera Chok.
Chapter 1, 2, 2003. Today marks my 16th year on this hot, horrible earth. I'm stuck in school, standing with my palms pressed against a green wall. I'm pressing so hard that my fingers ache. I am tethered to this wall by my own shame. I'm in trouble again. I keep finding myself in trouble. It takes me weeks to wade out of it. There's something dishonest about my face, even when I'm telling the truth. What can you do when you're born with a bad face? I think that's why most people don't take to me. Yes, take to me. The way that ducks take to water or kids take to certain talents. The way the other girls in school seem to be best friends in seconds. In-jokes and easy laughter. When I was 11, I used to hope that puberty would morph me, that one day I'd uncurl from my chrysalis, bloom out beautiful. No luck. Acne instead. Disgusting hair. Blood. I take after my father's side, apparently, the homely ashen Ungs, a family of grifters and gamblers, smugglers and runaways. People are superficial, whether they admit it or not. I wouldn't be stuck here if I looked even a tiny bit more like my mother, who is a monster, but so stunning that she can get away with anything. Even when she's not around, I can feel my mother's eyes on my back, the pinprick glare of her disapproval. True horror fans know her as Amisa Tan. Screen name, Amisa Tan Xiao Feng. Day to day, she is the kind of woman who never sweats, who wouldn't be caught dead talking with a mouthful of food. She eats like a bird, smokes like a chimney. Back when she left the house more often, she used to get fruit and flowers offered to her like some sort of pagan goddess at the wet market by stuttering men of all ages who also competed to help her with her bags. She accepted the free gifts, but declined the manpower, made me carry all the shopping instead. All the way home, cars slowed in stately reverence as my mother sauntered down the roadside, me trailing behind her. Strained plastic handles cut into my palms, the weight of future dinners ached my shoulders and forearms. Right now, I keep staring at the wall, because if I shut my eyes, I might fall asleep for a second, standing up like a horse. This wall is the shade of car sickness and cheap mint ice cream. Behind me is the staff room. I hear the teachers going in and out of the swinging wooden doors. If I strain my ears, I tell myself I can make out the scratching of ballpoint pens. Scritch, scratch, wrong answer, incorrect. Right now, Madam Go and Mrs. Fok and Mr. Singh are marking our test scripts. Mother tongue and elementary mathematics and chemistry. I already know it. I have that familiar sinking feeling in my stomach that I am not going to do well.
You are not doing well, Sue. You need to buck up, Mrs. Fok tells me.
And that is part of why I am in public detention. The other reason is because I am disruptive and also too old, Mrs. Fok continues, to be upsetting my classmates with the things that I am saying. Elizabeth Kui is the new girl who transferred over from St. Magdalene's Secondary School 2 weeks ago. She is half a head shorter than me and as sweet and manufactured as Japanese candy. She has a cluster of ripening pimples spread across her right cheek, inflicted, perhaps, by a dirty pillow and firm preference of sleeping angle.
I thought maybe we could be friends. But she is the one who told Mrs. Fogg that I am a compulsive liar and that I spend all day whispering weird, creepy things to her. The part about talking to her all day is true, especially during the draggy afternoon periods. The weirdness I disagree with. I am the most normal person that I know. Singapore lies just 1 degree north of the equator, and it feels like the bull's eye where the sun is aiming a shot at the earth with the intention of killing it. In the afternoons, this building heats up like a copper coil stove. The classroom is so sweltering that all 33 of us sweat out half our body weight, a form of suffering which the girls most committed to their eating disorders view as beneficial and beautifying. The cooked classroom smells like impulse deodorant and soiled sanitary pads. The perspiration makes our starched button blouses turn translucent as onion peel and stick to the skin. Lurid bra straps and push-up cup lines emerge like litmus blooming through filter paper. Neon pink, acid green, boudoir red. Unorthodox colours for our prim and proper all-girls school. My own bra is always beige. Mrs. Chan, who is in charge of pastoral care, has already swapped my sitting partner 5 times this year. I have exhausted everyone. My classmates call me Sadako after the Ringu drowned girl and prefer to leave me alone. That is, until they get intolerably bored and decide to make my life miserable. For now, even the cruelest and most perfect girls prefer to pretend that I don't exist. Clara Chua, Lee Mei Si, and Trissy Kwok are a three-headed vision of stem glass necks and crystal clear skin, branded satchels, and understated sexual experience. They are as idle and cunning as crocodiles. They are unknowable and invincible. Their limpid eyes judge and glint. Every morning, in unison, they twist their shampoo advert hair gently in their hands and draw it over their shoulders like a rifle sling. Ours is a convent school, the Whampoa Convent of the Eternally Blessed. But there is nothing pious about the things that teenage girls inflict upon each other. In this place, it is not the weird girls, the too freakish to engage with, who are the minced meat, but the less well-off, the ones who can't afford good school bags or sports shoes, or else the weaklings, the watery-eyed and too quick to please. I've seen girls torn to pieces for agreeing with the wrong thing. I've seen girls strung up like joints of char siu or roast duck in the dirtiest toilets, panties exposed, gulping back tears for offending one of the crocodiles or associates of the crocodiles. Always in some minute, impossible way. Blinking for too long so as to appear contemptuous, coughing too comically, saying some misjudged, stupid thing. I don't believe in holy ghosts, but right at the start of my time here, 3 forever years ago, at that inauspicious age of 13, I used to say this prayer every morning, in time to my footsteps before I entered the gates. I pray to bird shit, I pray to the trees, I pray to the walkway, I pray to the construction cranes, nobody be bad to me, let me be okay. Amen. 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 The wrought iron school gates are painted the same shade as banana foam gums, to mimic the pliability of marshmallows, when there is no easy escape. A nauseating candy palette forms the colour scheme of our school, to soften the blow of the horrors within. Mint green walls by the staff room, senile lilac by the concourse, blush pink and cloud blue on the tall, tacky spires that make up the east and west wings. I spend more time in this compound than I do anywhere else. I wish it would burn down in my sleep. Yesterday, I saw a mirage on the whiteboard. If I believed in God, I would call it a holy vision. Mrs. Fox's marker pen squiggles began to jump around on the surface, flow and skip like the volume lines on a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.